Okay, thanks everybody for calling in. I'm Amy Grieco, and I am here today with Edan Lepucki, who is the author most recently of California. You had a book before that called If You're Not Yet Like Me, more of a novella, yeah? Mm-hmm. Edan's also a staff writer at The Millions, and she teaches and founded the Los Angeles Writing Workshops of Los Angeles. So thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
So I guess the first question that everybody asks at this point is, you know, you debuted at number 3 on the New York Times list. You were number 1 on the LA Times list for California. What does it feel like?
It feels pretty good. this was only a few weeks ago, but, you know, Little Brown, I always say now when someone from your publishing house calls you on speakerphone and there are many people on the call, that's a really good news. So I feel like there were 10 people, if not more, like giddy to tell me that it had debuted at number 3 on the New York Times list, just because, I mean, that's just ridiculous.
That's
so
insane.
We're really excited. And I had just left a museum with my son, and we were in Marin County in California, and he fell asleep in the car, and I was driving across the Richmond Bridge, mm-hmm. so over the bay, like the water's just glittering and beautiful green blue, and I just burst into tears just driving, like, I'm so happy. So it still feels really magical and really hard to believe that it happened.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
So most people describe the book sort of as a literary dystopia. Do you feel like that accurately sums it up? How do you feel about that?
I feel pretty good. you know, I think it's weird because it's a speculative novel that takes place about 40 years in the future.
Uh-huh.
And it's not too sunny, right? Things don't look good for our world. So dystopia or post-apocalyptic makes sense. I think literary, it's always a complicated term, but it's sort of character-driven fiction, so that would make sense. It's not quite... post-apocalyptic doesn't seem like exactly the right term at times because it's not as if it's post an event. It's
right,
sort of
right.
Things just got worse and worse and life just went on. So I don't think it's exactly right, but I think I don't think there's a better term. So it works for me. I think it's enough to get people to look at the book, and then when they start reading, they can decide.
Figure out where they want to put it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So when you were writing, I mean, is it a conscious decision to sort of just have civilization start to peter out as opposed to, you know, a giant neutron bomb or something like that?
That would have been good. I didn't want it to be a singular event. I knew that much. But it wasn't like there was a lot of intention behind my building of this post-apocalyptic world. I basically just took the things that I'm anxious about. So like climate change and the idea of oil running out and we're all screwed because of that.
Right.
You know, the rich getting richer and richer and then leaving everyone else to kind of rot. I took all of those things that were sort of bubbling in my consciousness and sort of in the news and just everyone kind of thinking about them, I think. And that's what I based the apocalypse on or based the world in. But I mostly, when I was writing, I was really just thinking about the characters, and a lot of the world building came afterwards, mm-hmm. With the help of my editor, Allie, sort of thinking about, okay, so there was an earthquake when Frida and her brother Micah were teenagers. Okay, mm-hmm. So there was an earthquake, and then the rich started leaving a city that couldn't rebuild, and then oil got soaked. So it was sort of like conjecturing and if then, and kind of building from there.
Nice.
But I often get this question of, well, why didn't you have just one thing happen? And I always say, well, it didn't really occur to me that I would just do one thing. I just sort of started writing, and the world emerged as I wrote.
So, I mean, we are talking about, you know, the end of the world and oil running out and all of this, but there are moments of really brilliant joy in the book as well. There's a scene where Frida and Cal are riding home on bicycles, I think, like through like abandoned Los Angeles.
Yeah.
Like, it must have been, like, I always remember that's a beautiful scene. It must have been kind of fun to destroy the world too.
It was really fun. I think it's really exhilarating, and I'd never written anything like it. And I think I always say, like, I got to destroy IKEA in a half a sentence, and that was such a thrill, just to be like, see you later, IKEA.
Right, no more meatballs.
Yeah, no more meatballs. So there was a real exhilaration to just being able to decide that certain places didn't exist anymore,
mm-hmm.
And to also really kind of mine this young love and to think about what it would be like to fall in love with someone and to feel that true connection, even as everything around you is sort of just going to hell and there are really no opportunities for you and your partner.
Mm-hmm.
So I tried to kind of play those off each other. So we have Frida and Cal who are, you know, they're living together in this tiny studio apartment, and I think there is something romantic about it. And I think maybe when you're in your early 20s and you're trying to get by, there is a little bit a little bit of an apocalyptic feeling, like totally. I'm one rent paycheck to the next, just trying to get by. So it's really trying to tap into that feeling.
Like us against the world.
This college loan is due. What am I going to do? I still know my college loan is due on the 4th, and I always think about it.
It's a little apocalyptic. Yeah. So it's interesting to me that this book feels so different from your novella, which is mm-hmm. based in the real world. And
yeah.
But as we're talking, I'm seeing like maybe there are some connections there. Do you feel like this is a huge departure for you, or do you feel like there's something at the core that you're always kind of writing about?
It's a good question. You know, my novella, which I like to say is a romantic comedy where nobody's happy.
And it's like the least comedy of romantic comedies,
but
great.
Funny, yeah. Right?
No, it is funny.
But it's narrated by this woman, and she's talking about this failed relationship. So they're very different in tone, mm-hmm. I think. Although I do think both texts are kind of about how people communicate or miscommunicate. And I think that's there in both, like a real desire to have intimacy and a kind of failure to get it is in both books. But I do think California was a departure for me in terms of creating a dystopia. Although writing the language was easy for me. Like I just sort of fell into the book and fell into the characters, and that came naturally to me. Although I did recognize it was different from the novella.
And the plot too, do you feel like the plot was sort of...
That was different for me. Yeah. I just feel like I really look up to Jennifer Egan, for instance,
You got a blurb from her. That must have been, I mean, best number 3 on the life. Times list, whatever, but a blurb from Jennifer Egan.
If she had been in the car, it would have been like the best moment. The universe would have exploded. I really admire the way that she will write. You know, she'll write a book like Look at Me, which is about image culture and mm-hmm. the supermodel, and there's terrorism, and there's like teenage girl having sex with her weird math teacher, all this stuff in one book, and then the next book will be like this contemporary gothic story about this castle in like Bavaria, and then the next book is this story collection with all these different forms. So I really admire writers who are able to jump from one kind of style or take on that kind of technical challenge. I find that really fun as a reader.
Uh-huh.
And I fear writing the same book over and over again.
Yeah.
I mean, that probably will happen, but I have some issues to work out in therapy. So I strive for that.
It's interesting because I think I just heard David Mitchell talk because his new book is out. And, you know, he is kind of coming to this realization as a writer that he is writing the same book over and over. And there are these characters. And I think he said something along the lines of, actually, I just realized that I'm writing like a massive book and it just has to be split out to separate ones.
That's a really cool way to think about it.
But I like the idea that there's sort of two different kinds of writers.
Yeah.
There's ones who are circling, you know, I wanted to say circling the drain. That's really rude. Circling the core ideas.
Yeah.
And there's others who are like, I just want to do something different every single time.
I mean, it would be interesting to, if I reread all of Jennifer Egan's books, for instance, there's probably a persistent question in all of them that's the same question. So I assume that's the case for David Mitchell as well.
Yeah.
So maybe everyone's just sort of writing one long book. It just takes sort of different avenues.
Right. You go in different directions.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, let's take our first question. We're going to ask Jess Cruz, if you can unmute and go ahead and ask your question for Edan.
Uh-oh. Hi.
Oh, great. Okay.
Hi.
Hey.
So my first question is, I recently read a post on Tumblr about the stories that we tell about the future. And we used to tell stories about flying cars and robotic dogs, but now we're telling stories about the collapse of society from greed. Is California meant to be a warning for the future?
That's a good question. First of all, what happened to the flying cars? I mean, we are in the Google Hangout, and I do not see a single hovercraft, and I am pissed. That's a really good question. I do think, right, we're living in really anxious times right now, and I think you see that in a lot of the art that people are making, a lot of these kind of apocalyptic narratives. I mean, I don't pretend to be able to know what the future holds for us, and I think in some sense, apocalypse narratives are cathartic for us both as creators and writers and as readers. So we get to enter into this devastated landscape and really face our fears of what would it be like to have to leave civilization and you read that and you feel that fear in the same way that you would go to a horror movie or something, and then you emerge and you're safe again. So I do think there's a cathartic aspect, and that's one way that we handle our anxieties about the future. I don't really think that apocalypse narratives are anything new, really. I mean, if you think about the story of the Garden of Eden, the fall from God's graces or whatever, I mean, that you could argue is the first apocalypse story. So I don't think it's anything new, but I do wonder also, like, I've talked to some people about this, like the rate of technology and the way that we are able to find out what's happening in the world and find out like a billion horrible stories a day across the world, I think that's for us is giving us a sense of real instability where we can, you know, look at our phone and tap into it and see the death that's going across, or like, you know, for instance, we can go see what's happening in Liberia right now and be freaked out about diseases and Ebola and stuff. And I think maybe technology and that is also affecting our sense of fear. I don't really think of California as a warning, because I don't think that's really fiction's job. I feel for me, fiction is just to enter into someone else's consciousness. That's really what fiction can do that other art forms can't. And in that process, if one emerges from my book thinking about, well, what can I do to make sure that I don't give the future this particular future, then that's great. Like, because I think Frida and Cal are in their situation because of things that have happened in our present, or have, you know, a waste of things and just not being cognizant of the environment and just not living in the present and not really caring. So I don't have a sort of lesson of, okay, if you don't do this, this will happen. But it would be lovely if spending time in the consciousness of Frida and Cal allowed people to sort of think about our present and think about what we might change, or just being grateful for what we have, then that would be wonderful for me. But I don't pretend to predict what will happen. And in some days I think that my book is total BS and we're going to be fine because the human race is innovative and smart and we're fighters in a good way.
And I think you had one more for us, Jess, right?
Yeah, I did. So my second question was, recently, Eleanor Catton announced that she'd be giving out grants so that authors would be able to read more in their spare time. What do you like to read in your spare time, and do you read while you're working on a novel?
What was the second part of that?
Do you like to read while you're working on your novels?
Okay, good question. First of all, when I read that Eleanor Catton was giving this award, I was like, oh my God, can I get that? Because I just was discussing how I wanted to read all of Dickens.
Uh-huh.
And then I was like, I'm going to go get a PhD in English literature. Bye, guys.
I assume you're talking to your son and husband.
Actually, I said that to my son, and he burst out crying. Oh, he was like, you can't do that! I was like, you don't even know what a PhD is. What are you talking about? So I think that's a really terrific fellowship. I love to read all kinds of things. Jennifer Egan was one of my, as I mentioned, is one of my favorites. I've recently been big into Edith Wharton. So I just read Custom of the Country and The House of Mirth, which have these terrific, really unlikable but complicated real female characters that I'm just so obsessed with. I really love Tom Drury. I love Stoner by John Williams, which is just the story of one guy's life.
That story is amazing.
Yeah, it will make you sob, and it's so perfectly told, sort of unassuming prose that I love. I'm going to read Dickens is like, I'm going to do this. I don't know why, but I've decided that Dickens is the next thing that I'm going to read.
Nice.
And I definitely read. I don't really understand. Unless people write super fast, I don't know how you can't read when you're writing. Like, California took 3 years. It's not like I'm going to take 3 years off reading. That would be so bizarre.
What would you do with your time?
I know. So I read all kinds of things. I tend to stay away from work that would be similar. So while I was writing California, I didn't read apocalypse or post-apocalyptic narratives for fear that they would kind of seep into my work. So I'm reading some of those now. I have The Parables by Octavia Butler that I'm really excited to read. Actually, Robin Sloan, who was so nice to blur my book, said I should read this. So I'm going to read that. But I just try to read as widely as I can. And right now I'm working on a book that does have a really complicated female narrator. So the Edith Wharton books have been really instructive for me, but they're so old and so different from anything that I would write that I don't feel like it's a bad idea to read her work at this creative juncture. So I'm always
like
reading.
Angry blogger or like a, you know, like a bitter fashionista.
Yeah, exactly. Which is not in my book
either. Not at all. But you know,
it's a bitter fashionista. I like it.
So that actually leads into another question that I had, which is, you know, you teach writing a lot, and how does that work with your writing? You know, do you find yourself teaching your students techniques that you've designed, or is it more, you know, here are a set of tools, you choose what you want to take out of the toolbox?
Well, now I teach at Writing Workshops LA, which is the school I founded, and now I live in the Bay Area, but my school's in Los Angeles. So before I left, I was teaching workshops at night in the evenings from my home or weekend mornings. And now that I live up north, I have just one group of novel students. So we've been working together since before when I was living in LA, and it's like five novelists.
Nice.
And I never wrote novel-length work when I was in graduate school. So I actually learned, everything I've learned about novel writing is from reading novels, writing and trying to write novels, and teaching novel writing. And novel writing has been the most instructive, just because I think seeing, and these classes, they start with just an idea or they have like one chapter, and we have multiple iterations of the class until we're at a final point where everybody has a finished manuscript.
Wow.
And then read the entire manuscript. So you kind of see the ways that stories get built, character arcs, and you kind of wrestle with all those questions.
Uh-huh.
There's certain things that you just can't see in a novel manuscript until you get to see the whole thing. So something that doesn't seem like a problem in a scene, when you see it over the course of the manuscript, then you can really talk about it and talk about solutions. As a teacher, I am not prescriptive in terms of like one should always do this or one should not do this. I like to take each text on their own merits. And my novelist students are, I always tell them like they should not be paying me. It feels like we're a writing group because they're so talented.
Sure, yeah.
And I've learned so much from them just in terms of, you know, we learn through getting deep into the text, deep into their work.
Mm-hmm.
So I just end up asking questions. Like, we always talk about the deeper subject of what they're working on, which is sort of like what it's about, not what happens. And I think having someone else tell you what the deeper subject of your work is really useful, because that can tell you, okay, like, well, I didn't mean that to be my deeper subject. Is that a useful deeper subject? Or did I go off? Like, is the actions of the characters giving the reader the wrong idea or something?
Yeah.
So we talk about that, and we just have kind of long, engaging, kind of intellectual discussions.
It sounds like a college course.
It's really
like, it's like old novels.
Yeah,
or something,
and there's,
you know,
also wine involved, so that helps.
That
too.
Does help. Yeah. It's
college plus wine. So I don't know if I'm really answering your question, but that's kind of how we kind of just base the text at hand, and we do a lot of close reading, and we read aloud, and we're really like, just, we've been working together for so long now, so there's a nice rapport going.
Right, right.
They're just so great. If you're any of you are listening, I love you guys.
So I know that you've also, you wrote for the Millions, all of these amazing pieces that were like, this is what my publicist does, like this is what my editor does, this is what my copy editor does, which I was really impressed by, because I think often you think of the copy editor as somebody that the author has like a very contentious relationship with, you know?
Yeah, I mean, I did the first one with my copy editor because I always had been kind of interested in a copy editor as a person. Like, what kind of person becomes a copy editor? Like, you have to be really kind of fastidious, I think. You have to be a close reader. You have to know grammar really well. And I think a person who knows grammar very well, I don't know, it's just an interesting mind, I think, almost like a mathematic mind.
Yeah.
But I was also interested in my copy editor's flexibility and the way that she would ask a question and then she would know how to correct something.
Mm-hmm.
So I really respected the hours that she put into the manuscript. So I wanted to interview her just because I was like, selfishly, I want to know all the answers.
Yeah, yeah.
But sometimes at the Millions, I try to make my role there, or one of the things that I want to do as a staff writer, is sort of like pull the veil away from some of the publishing stuff. So I had a novel before California that didn't sell, and I wrote an essay about like what it feels like when your agent sends your book out for a year and it doesn't sell, because I just felt like, you know, this is an experience that a lot of writers have, and that it might be useful for other writers who are going through that experience or writing a novel now to know, like, you know, if you finish this novel and it doesn't sell, it's not the end of the world, and it's certainly not the end of your career.
Absolutely, obviously.
And so then after I did the copy editing thing, it was really popular. People were like me, interested in Susan's, you know, way of seeing. So of course I had to interview my editor because we had a really fun time, and it was a long, in-depth process of revising my book and talking about it. And, you know, people say editors don't edit.
Well, absolutely. That's like such a truism
now. I was starting to feel bad about myself because I was like, are editors not editing because they're overworked? Or like, is my book just so bad that my editor's like, she needs some help here? So, I mean, but I was just ultimately grateful for her help. So I thought it would be useful for that. And I just think people have interests in like, what does a publicist do all day?
Absolutely, yeah. Right? Like, so. That's, I thought it was a really great series to have
Thanks.
Out there. And you were on Flatman Crooked before, right? Which was,
Dina, yeah. And she's incredible.
So you've had, like, these amazing
I've had two editors who are so smart and younger than I am, and I'm just like, where did you come from? Did you just emerge fully formed in the womb? Like, just knowing what you, knowing all that you know? I'm like, God, when I was your, I mean, not that they're that much, but I'm always like, how do you know what you're doing? God, so annoying and accomplished.
So let's kick it over to our participants as well. Mary, are you there? We'd love to hear what you have to ask Edan.
Hi. Hi, Edan.
Hi.
Hey, Frida's brother, Micah, I felt was a paradox. In the one moment, he seemed to have real concern for the balanced society. And the next, he was a very dangerous individual.
Yes.
So is Micah based on someone from today's society or a conglomeration of people?
My brother was a just kidding. That was a horrible joke. I'm sorry. For the record, Amy laughed. He's not. I don't ever write characters that are based on anyone. Micah is one of my favorite. He was the most challenging character to write, but also the most fun to write. I wanted a villain. I thought it would be fun to have a villain. I wanted him to sort of do all these horrible, cruel, violent things. But at the same time, I don't think that's a very interesting character. So I wanted to give him humanity. And the best way to do that was to think about how his sister felt about him. And, you know, he's her younger brother. And so no matter what he's done or will do, she has an affection for him and a tenderness towards him, and she's protective of him in some ways. So that I was able to kind of tap into his humanity that way. And then actually in the revision process with my editor, Allie, we talked a lot about the group, which is the terrorist organization that Micah is part of, and thinking about their history and their beginnings and coming up with how the group began, you know, starting out trying to, like, you know, correct some of the inequality issues between the classes in LA, and started by college students who were just, you know, upset that they had all this debt and no career prospects. Using that as sort of thinking about how the group began, and thinking about a man who actually did want to help a city, and thinking about how he wanted to give people opportunities, and to think about how that could morph into something evil was really a fascinating question to me, and the evolution of Micah was really kind of fun to discover. But he's not based on any real person I know or a person in the public eye.
He felt like such a younger brother to me. Maybe that's just because I have a younger brother, but I was like, oh, of course.
Oh my God. What's so funny is, so I have a younger brother who's he's 12 years younger than I am.
Oh, wow.
Maybe 11 and a half years younger than I am. And he's not anything like Micah at all. If anything, he would be more like Cal on the spectrum of characters. I have a younger sister who's just, they're very close in age, and they're quite a bit younger than me. So one day she texted me, and she was like, oh my God, Asher has no idea that he's Micah. And she was like, LOL. And I was like, what are you talking about? Because Asher is very smart.
Uh-huh.
And I guess she was like, that makes her Frida. I just was like, you guys have your own issues that has nothing to do with my book.
It's kind of great that your family, like, wants to insert themselves in.
Yes,
you know?
They always.
Didn't your mother-in-law have to, like, she was like, I can't believe you killed me.
No, she said, she told my husband, I really like the book. And then she's like, but I was sad when I died in the snowstorm, which I thought was adorable and deeply weird that she
thought that was her. Yeah. Yeah. Not a bad way to go, though.
Yeah.
It's not like you had her or something.
I mean, she could have been beheaded.
Exactly.
So
exactly.
To count your blessings.
And I think you had another question for us, Mary.
Nope.
Okay. Yeah, I do.
Oh, great. Fantastic.
A lot of the readers on Goodreads, actually. I'm sorry, can you hear me?
Yes.
Oh, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. There were reviewers on Goodreads who stated their disappointment because there was a lack of an explanation for the environmental and societal devastation. But I love that this novel had such a strong literary sensibility. And so what or who influenced you to write California's character-driven? Just is that, I think earlier you had stated that that's basically how you started.
Yeah, good question.
With the novel.
Yeah, that's a really good question. I wanted to write about these characters and write about a marriage. That was sort of the central focus of the book. That's sort of the book's project. And I think actually if you're looking for the book to be more about the world, you will be disappointed because my focus, the project of the book, I think it's really a book about marriage more than it is about the world. Mm-hmm. So it's sort of like what is intimacy like, and what is connection like, and what is love like, what is loyalty like, the backdrop of all this despair, I guess, the high stakes of the end of the world. And it didn't really occur to me, because I mostly read character-driven fiction and that's what I like, it didn't occur to me to try it any other way, and I don't think I really could. I don't have the skill to write a book that has something else at its focus, and that's what I'm most interested in as a writer, of sort of they would do something and seeing the world as they would and sort of existing in their bodies. Those things are really important to me, so that's sort of what I went with. And thinking about if I'm really in their perspective, I mean, they're isolated in the wilderness, so they had enough information. They had information up until a certain point, and then they're out in the woods. So issues of like what's going down with the government, or like a lot of more world building, I think would be impossible because I'm staying true to the perspective of my characters. So yeah. I can't really give more than what they already know.
I mean, the interesting thing to me about this book is that, you know, Frida sort of comes off at the beginning like a very traditional character. You know, she's doing the washing and all of these things because the society, you know, society has fallen apart, right? Her husband's out doing traditionally male things. But they're both sort of boundary crossers, and that Frida's like, let's just go see what's in the woods. Let's see what's a little further out there. And so one of the questions that I had is, you know, when does going further start to cross sort of the boundaries of morality? You know, when do they cross that line, do you think?
Amy? That's a really good question. I mean, I think a lot of readers haven't connected with Frida, or they find her frustrating. I mean, I definitely find her frustrating at times. but I find her impetuousness and her sort of drive to just do what she needs to do. Like, she almost, like, talk about, she's not a very cerebral character to me. She's someone mm-hmm. who kind of just works by intuition and just does what she needs to do. So she often does stuff kind of without really thinking through. And that's what I think makes her a really interesting character.
Absolutely.
I forget what the question was now.
You know, like where morality comes into it, you know?
Yeah.
Especially morality in this society that's crumbled completely. Yeah. I mean, you're kind of making it up as you go
yeah.
along.
I mean, there is this hope, I think, at the beginning, or there was hope when they were at the Millers, that like make the world over. Like if you have these two families, whatever relationships you have with each other, your children will inherit and act out with their partners. And mm-hmm. on an interpersonal level, you're sort of passing along those things. But when the Millers are found dead, sort of that goes out the window, and they have to sort of figure out what comes next. I mean, I do yeah. think some of the things that the land does, I mean, you could argue that some of the rules make sense in a world that's not our world. I think oftentimes parents have to make horrible choices.
Yes, absolutely.
I mean, I met with this book club and we talked about parents like in Honduras who have to mm-hmm. Who are sending their kids across the border because Honduras is so violent. And, you know, young girls they're getting IUDs put in them, and then they're pushing them out into the desert. And I think those are good parents.
Yeah.
They're doing what they're in their lack of options, and they're going with the one they think is the best. And I think that's just heartbreaking. So I'm really interested in the ways that we try to do the best, and we often fail because not because we're awful people, just because there's just not a lot of choices out there. So I don't know.
I think you see that in The Road a lot as well. McCarthy said he wrote specifically because he had a kid so late in life, and it really gave him this new perspective on mortality and yeah. what's going to happen. Does that resonate with you at all?
It does. I mean, I remember when I was very newly pregnant and not telling anyone, I went to a book club discussion of freedom, mm-hmm. and I went on this whole tirade about like how like we shouldn't have kids because like, man, we are screwed, and all this stuff is so bad, and like, and then there was like kind of a lull, like, whoa. And this woman was like, you're obviously not having children. And then all along I was pregnant. So I have these real fears about what my kid is going to face and what can I teach him so that he can be a person that's good and can mm-hmm. do good and to make the world better. And I definitely have those feelings.
Yeah.
Although maybe the mortality thing a little bit less because I'm not old
yeah.
man.
You're
like Cormac.
Yeah.
That's just weird.
So let's kick it over to the participants again. Kat, are you there?
I am.
Great. We'd love to hear your question.
Okay. I was just wondering if you're working on a sequel or maybe like a different version of the book from maybe Micah's point of view.
Ooh, that's a good one.
You should write that. That sounds amazing.
Fan fiction.
I'm not currently working on a sequel, which is the most popular reader question. I'm working on a contemporary, a book that takes place in the contemporary era right now, which I've been working on for a while. And it's kind of a relief to not be in the apocalypse for a while. It's kind of a downer, you guys. but after I finished, you know, it was an unresolved ending, and I thought it was very literary. There's an open door, as Ethan Kanan, my teacher at Iowa, always said, write an ending that is an open door so the reader can walk through and imagine what comes next. I thought that's what I did. But apparently I knew there was a lot of unresolved stuff. But after I finished, I had a couple of really strong images sort of popped into my mind. I'm not going to divulge them. And they weren't really plot-oriented or anything. They were just sort of, the way that books' ideas come to me is like, just like an image, like, you know, like I had an image very early on when I was writing California of this woman pregnant in a sparkling kitchen.
Wow.
Which then became the ending of the book. I mean, she's not in the kitchen in the actual ending. But so I had this little image pop up, and so I knew it was in the universe of California, but I know it's not right after where this current book ends.
Mm-hmm.
So I knew when I got that, I was like, oh no. God, not again. No, I don't want to go back to the apocalypse. And then all these questions about the sequel have definitely spurred me on to want to write, to like to fulfill readers' interests. Like, I'm so flattered that people want to continue in this world. So I think after I finish this contemporary book, I will try to see where that image is taking me.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
I would like to know. I would love to hear from Micah's point of view. I think that would be very
interesting. But Micah, I don't know if I could handle Micah's point of view. That's like a thorny, thorny wilderness.
Yeah.
It's a good idea, though. I like that.
I mean, it's like one of the Goodreads, we've just started doing this thing where people can ask the author questions, and I've always been surprised to see how often people say, you know, I love these characters, will you be revisiting these characters in another book?
Yeah.
Or I wonder if that's like a new phenomenon or if that's sort of been around forever. Because before, I feel like, you know, no one was calling Don DeLillo to say, you know, can you do this again?
Yeah. I think also if you think about it, I was writing California, it took 3 years. So I was like in the world for 3 years, and then there's like another two of after that. So like, I feel like I know them all very well, but I'm like, that I'm sort of done with that particular story, whereas a reader is with it for a couple weeks maybe.
Right.
So they're like, I want more. And the writer's like, ah, I've been here for many years. I'm ready to go to a new land. But there's been so many sequels for books that I think also there may be that expectation as well.
And it must be nice as a writer to sort of think like, okay, I've done this 3 years of research. I'm going to put out another book, with, you know, maybe in a shorter period of time.
Yeah.
Maybe.
That would be nice. Maybe. We'll see.
What's the international reception been to California?
Oh, it came out in England.
Uh-huh.
It's been very positive in England, actually.
I think
I was a little nervous with like the book called California would.
Right.
I mean, I know California has an international brand recognition, but I still was nervous about it. But they seem to. It seems to be appealing to them. And I just sold the German rights.
Hey!
So if you're like Spain, you should call me.
I mean, I was just reading about The Handmaid's Tale because I feel like the comparisons between these two books are very similar.
Which is one of my favorite books.
Is it really?
Yes, love it.
Margaret Atwood wrote an essay for The Guardian in which she was like, you know, the funny thing is when we talk about The Handmaid's Tale in other countries, people sort of deal with it as a literary object, right? They talk about it as a book. But in America, everyone's just kind of like, oh, how much longer do you think we have? Like, you
know? That's so interesting.
Yeah, like we're sort of just treating these dystopians as like what the future will be, you know?
Yeah, I think, I mean, I have found so far, I mean, I haven't done any like interviews for English papers or anything, but the review seems similar in terms of like treating it as a, you know, I didn't see like a particularly British way of dealing with the apocalypse.
Right.
Although maybe they're like, this is what it's going to be like in California, which is far away from us in England.
Which is, I mean, it's funny, you never even say in the book that it's actually in California, right?
No.
It's kind of, we just all kind of infer it. Yeah.
Well, that's kind of what I like about the title, besides I just like the word California, but. You know, they never say where they are, but then the book is like a definitive declaration of where they are. Kind of like,
exactly.
I'm like, here you go.
Do you have a specific part of the state that you picture when
No. This is really funny because people are like, People have really specific, I've had readers at readings be like, so I was thinking it was, and they get very specific.
Like
but,
they've done research. Like, yeah. And these they, mushrooms I mean, would be.
I got lost meeting my publicist this morning because I walked in the wrong direction and I walked for way too far before I was smart enough or stupid enough to stop. So I just have a zero sense of direction, and that's sort of how I always have lived my life. Like, I didn't even know my major street names in LA until I had to drive and learn them. Uh-huh. So it makes sense that I would write a book in the middle of nowhere that was never actually located anywhere, because that's kind of how my brain works.
Yeah.
I will say that they go north, so, and there's redwoods around there, so you could say it's kind of in that area. So people are like, I think it's in the Angeles Forest. I'm like, oh, yeah, it sounds good.
Right.
I mean, in some sense, it doesn't really matter. They're kind of like in a post-map society. Like, if you don't really leave your little circle of place, then why does it matter where you are in the larger span of things?
That's a really good point, actually.
That's
like,
my,
they probably
that's my
don't
argument.
Even know.
Yeah. I mean, I think they know, but does it, is it imperative to know?
Yeah.
I don't think so.
This actually leads really nicely into our question from Meg. Are you there, Meg? Can you hop on and ask your question?
Hi, guys.
Hi.
Hi.
Yeah, so I was interested in hearing more about the title. So I know it refers to the state, as we were just talking about, but it also refers to the character Calvin, who Micah calls California when they first meet. So I just wanted to know, with the title, is that also meant to reflect Cal's transformation throughout the book?
Ooh, you guys are just way too smart.
Right?
Who let these smarty pants into the Google Hangout? That's a great way of putting it. Yeah, so it has a kind of a number of resonances, I hope, for the reader. So California is where they are, although it's never said in the book. Cal in college, Micah calls him California, and I wanted that, I mean, to Cal, he sort of, it kind of needles him that his friend is calling him this and kind of making fun of him, and I think you're right, Cal becomes someone literally that is not, he's literally not himself by the end of the novel, and he does become infected, I think, by this notion of power and of kind of usefulness. He, I think he gets infected by the idea that he can be useful in this horrible world. And so he does become someone else. So that's a good way of putting it. Also, somebody had said that if you say Cal and Frida together really fast, it sounds like Calfrida, Calfrida. It kind of sounds like California. So I thought that's kind of a clever way to think about it. Also, I think California as a place has such sort of like a mythic
oh, yeah.
place in our American consciousness. You know, I'm from LA. I think people have a lot of ideas of what it means to be from LA or to be from California. And I think if you're from California, you're conscious. Like when I went to college in Ohio, people had so many preconceived notions about LA. It was really like I'd come from an alien planet. And so working with sort of the mythic ideas of California as the promised land, as sort of like place of innovation, and kind of turning that on its head. So we have this sunny state, but this is the very shadowy side of it, or this is the promised land, but it's gone horribly wrong. It's actually, in fact, a place that is, you know, it's obviously not the promised land. And thinking, too, like California, there's a line that Cal says, he's far from everything, including the California that he used to know. So in some ways, like you were saying, like he's far from his own like pure plank student, good son of a single mom, loving husband. He's very far from all those things, but he's also far, he's geographically in California, but he's gone so far from the home that he made there that it's like unrecognizable. So those are sort of all the levels of the title for me.
Yeah, I found him really interesting because he's such a like a man's man almost, you know, like he went to this college that was all about like agrarian societies.
Yeah.
Is that right? I mean,
yeah. But they're still like, it's based in part on Deep Springs College,
oh, okay,
which is an all-male two-year college at the foot of the Sierra Nevadas. But I went to Oberlin, which is a small liberal arts college. And I think if you went to a small liberal arts college, they all have something in common. And so like,
hacky sacks.
Yeah. Not hacky sacks, God. But like, you know, sort of like that heady, you know, like the idea that reading theory will in fact save your life and rescue you from living in a certain kind of way. But in fact, and it can in a lot of ways, like I was saved in college by reading the feminist critic Judith Butler.
Nice.
But at the same time, I, you know, you have to actually live in the world and that's not the world. So I was really working with that and thinking about like super abstract dudes.
Interesting. So less about the guys who are like watering the horses and more about the guys who are reading somebody talking about watering the horses
exactly.
1,000 years ago. Yeah.
And I mean, I think that kind of college is interesting because they're doing both. Right?
Absolutely. So. Yeah. Well, and there's a movement now towards, you know, shopcraft as art and all of that.
Exactly.
You know?
Local everything.
Exactly. Yeah. Right. Yeah. I mean, it's funny because part of the conversation is around, like, what does it mean? Like, what will we be like as men and women when we're sort of in this future society? Yeah. You know, like, will all of the advancements that we've had kind of roll back a little bit?
I mean, I sincerely hope not, but that was something that was like one of the deeper subjects of the book
Absolutely.
For me was sort of like that question for me of if our modern world goes away, all the things that I'm good at will also go away. And then what value do I have? Mm-hmm. And will we be reduced to these roles in a way that freaked me out.
Yeah, that's a really sad thought.
Yeah.
You must have had a really dark day to come up with
very
that.
Dark day. Really, very dark.
So we brought you a present that we thought might be useful to you.
You guys.
Yeah. This is what we do at Goodreads.
Oh.
And there's something in there for you that
I knew
that's
what
yellow one.
So maybe you could talk a little bit about the role of the turkey baster. I assume you've collected
one. I have,
every
this is my third,
so
but this is the first yellow one, actually.
Oh, good, okay,
yeah.
Perfect.
Thank you.
Well, Thanksgiving is coming, so you're going to need
a
bunch
anyway. Yeah, the other two were stolen by my son, who makes it a sword, which everything is a sword if you have a three-year-old. You know, it's so funny, I've read a couple Goodreads reviews that say, like, she gets a little kinky with the turkey baster, and I'm like, God, you guys have dirty minds. Man, oh, man.
They do, but they're also curiously, like, prudish when they're like, all these people do have sex. And, like, I read a blog post of yours that was like, I really don't.
Let's say, for the record, it covers, like, what, 6 weeks? They're the only ones around. There's no TV or internet or job to go
to.
It's
summer.
They have sex 3 times.
Yeah.
Like, that's not a ton of sex, you guys. I'm really worried about people. We need to have more sex. The book actually was started by an exercise that I was giving for my students where I was, have your character possess a possession that no one else knows they have.
Oh, interesting.
So I had this idea in my head that I was going to write about this couple at the end of the world. So I was like, I guess I'll just start. And I just put, her name wasn't Frida, she was just she, I think. And she just randomly had a turkey baster.
Uh-huh.
And I was like, well, that's weird. But when you're doing a writing exercise, you have 10 minutes to kind of just do whatever. So I have my subconscious just put it on the page and I did something with it, but it did seem to work because we have like kind of the pregnancy joke. But there's so much stuff. I wanted to write a domestic drama, so I like that she was holding this sort of like household object.
Right, kind of obscure, like super like feminine. You have to like cook a turkey to
have
it,
like,
you
it's
know?
No, there doesn't rely really on any technology.
Right.
And then I liked that it was just so worthless. Like, the idea that if you have nothing, then you would start making something a treasure that wasn't a treasure. And for me, Frida is very attracted to objects, and you could call her materialistic in some ways, but I think she finds comfort and she desires things and she doesn't have them. So she needs to make, she has to do that for herself. She has to make something desirous that isn't normally desirous. So I liked that. I didn't think she was fondling it as much as some readers said, but whatever, guys.
It's your subconscious, even.
I'm in love with the turkey baster. And then I, once it was there, and I wanted, I was actually surprised that she brought it with her to the land.
Uh-huh.
So I was like, okay. There she is. Okay. And it made a lot of sense that it came back. So
I like that your characters can still surprise you.
They're always doing it. They're so well, they do not behave.
Because I kind of thought of it as more a piece of, you know, there's that little kid walking around and he's got the shirt on that says Pussy Inspector.
Yeah.
And his parents tell him it's a mushroom.
A mushroom, yeah. That's actually one of my favorite parts
it's
of the whole book.
It's the funniest part of the book. And I feel like it's like part of like the detritus, right? It's like this modern society has fallen apart, and what do we have? We have like turkey basters and like
stupid
off-color
t-shirts. Yeah.
Like, what were we doing, you know?
No wonder the world ended. We were
right,
making
like
shirts
fiddling
like this.
While Rome burns, you know? So I thought that was like a very nice touch.
Yeah, thanks.
Yeah. So I think we're going to wrap it up there. Thank you so much to all of our participants who joined in. It was really great to hear your questions.
Thank you.
And thanks, Edan.
Thank you. Amy. Thank you guys so much for the questions and hanging out. That's great.
Bye.
Bye.
Thanks, Edan.
Thank you.